Hello, everyone. Just give people a few moments to jump on. Got some folk from Victoria, some from Tassie online, South Australia. Good to have you all. Okay, just give it a minute or so. Okay, very good. Thank you for joining our webinar today. Welcome. We are going to be talking about tomato potato psyllid and zebra chip in potatoes. With us, we have two speakers who will provide an update on the surveillance project and findings for TPP and Liberibacter in Australia, and also some insights on from our neighbours in New Zealand on how they have been managing TPP through the adoption of an integrated pest management program. The webinar today is being recorded and will be available on the PotatoLink website and distributed to registrants once the session has concluded. PotatoLink is the Hort Innovation Australian Potato Industry Communication and Extension Project, which is funded by the Fresh and Processing Potato Levy and government funds. While the project is managed by Hort Innovation, Applied Horticultural Research is the team contracted to deliver the project. My name is Steph Tabone and I'll be facilitating the webinar today. I'd like to introduce our two speakers for today's webinar, Dr. Melinda Moir and John Jackson. Dr. Melinda Moir is an entomologist from the Western Australian Department for Primary Industries and Regional Development. She has over 20 years of experience in academia and government. She's written over 50 peer-reviewed journal articles and 35 scientific reports and public interest articles on insects, spiders, and other invertebrates. Melinda has been working on the tomato potato psyllid since it arrived in Australia in 2017. She's been working primarily in diagnostics and surveillance and is also the project leader for the Hort Innovation National TPP and CLSO or Liberibacter Surveillance Project. So welcome Melinda to the webinar today. With us, we also have John Jackson, who's been involved in the potato industry for more than 40 years and has recently retired as the agricultural director for McCain's Foods for Australia and New Zealand. He has experience in crop procurement, strategic planning, research and development, agronomy, and company operations. John began his career over 45 years ago for J. Waddy Canneries in Timaru, New Zealand, with their vegetable processing operation. John was involved with the inception of McCain's Foods' first manufacturing operations. They now have two processing plants in New Zealand, which process in excess of 200,000 tonnes of potatoes and vegetables annually. John is presently a non-executive director of McCain Foods Limited, a director of the Potato Seed Cooperative Limited, a director of Potatoes New Zealand, and is also the chair of the Canterbury Potato Liberibacter Initiative since its establishment in 2021. So I'd like to welcome both of our speakers, and with us you can see that we have an absolute wealth of knowledge here. In today's webinar, Melinda is going to provide insight into the bacterium that causes zebra chip in potatoes and its vector tomato potato psyllid. She'll give some background on its arrival in Australia and an overview of the current surveillance project in place, along with its findings. Melinda will also provide some guidance on how you can get involved and who to contact in your regions. John is going to talk about TPP in New Zealand, providing some overview to the situation there and also how they have managed it through an integrated pest management approach, as I'm sure there's much that we can learn from what they've been doing in New Zealand. And John will also provide some background into the Canterbury Potato Liberibacter Initiative. After that, we'll have a Q&A where you're welcome to pop your hand up and we can take you off mute to ask questions. Otherwise, you're welcome to pop your questions in the Q&A function in the webinar. And at the end of the webinar, I can provide a brief update on some resources that you might be able to access for more information on TPP and zebra chip, and also some updates on our upcoming events or upcoming potato industry events in the near future. So with that, I'll hand over to Melinda to share her screen and start the webinar.
Can you see that, Steph?
Yeah, perfect. Thank you.
Okay, great. I thought I'd start with CLSO, the bacterium that causes psyllid yellows and zebra trip in potatoes, and it has other symptoms in other crop plants. It's vectored by what we call plant lice or lerp insects, and this includes the tomato potato psyllid. Now, CLSO is found in the Northern Hemisphere from North America to Central America through to Europe and Northern Africa. In North America and Central America, it's vectored by the tomato potato psyllid, which we call TPP. It's vectored within the salivary glands. The TPP carry it around. When they go to feed on their host plants, they transfer the bacterium into the host plant, and then the host plant becomes infected. It was found in New Zealand in 2006, and then in Norfolk Island in 2015. Unfortunately, TPP brought along with it the bacterium. In Europe, we have a different psyllid that vectors CLSO, that's Troia apicalis. In Europe and Northern Africa, we have another psyllid, Bacteria trigonica. These psyllids are both carrot psyllids, so they feed on different host plants to TPP. Fortunately, we don't have either of these in our regions in the Southern Hemisphere. Now, TPP was first discovered on mainland Australia in 2017, in February 2017, in Perth, Western Australia. As soon as it was found, we moved fairly quickly and an incident was declared. By March 2017, we were trapping for TPP to work out how far it had spread in Perth and beyond. We did this by recruiting members of the public, government staff, local councils to become adopter trappers. That means you take a trap and you set it up in your backyard and then you submit these series of traps to be assessed for TPP. So we did 4 weeks of trapping in March, and since then we've trapped every autumn and spring for 4 weeks looking for TPP, but more importantly now looking for CLSO. Luckily, CLSO was not brought in with the incursion into Perth. We target annually 1,690 TPP to test for CLSO, to give us more confidence that we actually don't have CLSO here in Australia. What do we look out for on plants? What are you going to see if you have TPP? Well, TPP begins its life cycle as a small, very, very small golden egg on a stalk. One female TPP can lay up to 500 eggs over 21 days. So you can get an outbreak of TPP really quite quickly. These eggs hatch into the juvenile stages, which we call nymphs. They have 5 instars of these, which gradually get larger. Every time these instars molt, they leave behind their exoskeletons, which look like little scales. The nymphs don't move around much. We know that a nymph is getting close to becoming an adult when you could see on this picture here, you see the wing buds on the larger nymphs. Finally, in the last molt, we get adults. Adults look quite different from the nymphs. They have wings and they can jump around, fly around. Often the adults are quite dark too, and they're a little bit larger than the nymphs. This whole life cycle can take 4 weeks, but it really is dependent on the weather and the host plants. We can get in one season, say in autumn, we can get 4 to 5 generations of psyllids. Now the adults, although the typical form, which is at the top, is sort of dark chocolate brown with white stripes, they do come in a variety of colours. Usually this indicates the age of the psyllid. Young psyllid adults are this very light yellow colour. You can't really see the white stripes very clearly. moving on to the darker colour as they get older. The easiest way generally to tell that you've got TPP is by putting out a yellow sticky trap. This yellow sticky trap here is covered in TPP. The larger insects are just flies, but the very small dots are individual TPP. Now in Australia, how can you tell if you've got TPP on your crops? Well, luckily we have a lot of native psyllids in Australia, hundreds of them, but so far only one psyllid that's native has been found on commercial solanaceous crops. That's Achisia solanicola. It's quite different in the coloration to TPP. It has a very dark body with a green abdomen. But most importantly, if you look at the antenna, if you can see those, it's got very light segments near its head, which turn into black segments further away from the body. TPP have black and white striped segments, so they look quite different, and they don't tend to change with the different colour morphs. If you have a magnifying glass at home, or lucky enough to have a microscope like we have here, there are further differences where you can really tell that you've got TPP. If you manage to capture an adult, one of the first things that we look for are these three veins here. It's one vein splitting into three. Most psyllids in Australia have one vein splitting into two. So this tells us, first of all, that we have the right family of psyllid. For TPP, a real indicator that you have TPP is this wavy bottom vein on the wing. It's very, very long, and it ends at the wing margin here after the split of the vein above it. So after this split here. Another indication which might be hard to see by a magnifying glass, but is this little lump, which is on about the third antennal segment. It's called a rhinarium. And finally, for us, if we're unsure, we dissect the male genitalia because that has species-specific structures that we look at. We can tell this is a male TPP because the last couple of segments are up in this little kick-up. A female has downturned genitalia that looks a little bit more like a parrot beak. What do we actually see on the plants? Well, these are predominantly tomato plants because we found TPP really like the tomato over here in Perth. First up, the eggs up in the top left-hand corner, they tend to be laid on their stalks along the leaf edges. So if you have really, really good eyesight, you might be able to see these rows of golden eggs. They are very, very small though. Next, you'll get the nymphs, which look like lerps or scale, but they're a golden colour, so they're slightly different from the typical scale that you might see, and they do move around a little bit more than scale do. In this particular photo, we've got a series of different instars of nymphs. We've got the really tiny ones that you can hardly see up to the ones that are about to change into adults. Then we get the adults. Now the darker ones can be confused with aphids. If you're just looking at them in the naked eye, they look very, very similar to aphids. What I'd also like you to pay attention to in these photos are the scale-like exoskeletons that are left behind, these white shells. Unfortunately, aphids also do that, so that won't separate them from aphids. But also these little white dots, which are actually the psyllid poo. We call it honeydew. If we get a big, big buildup of honeydew, you can get outbreaks of sooty mold. What do we actually see on the plants themselves? Well, the TPP feeding damage results usually in curled leaves. We can see here on this potato plant, and it can become yellow. Particularly if you've got a fairly large outbreak, you'll find yellowing with brown splotches as the leaf dries out. If you have CLSO in your crop, you'll start to see that the plants will prematurely yellow. They will be stunted, they'll shrivel up, they'll die early. The potato tubers themselves will be very small. You may also notice that there's a slight purple tinge to the growing tips of the potato plants. And of course, giving the disease zebra chip its name, if you fry up the tubers, you get this very distinctive dark brown and white stripes on the chips of the potato. Now, the easiest way, rather than looking for TPP on the leaves, the easiest way to know whether you've actually got TPP is to set out a yellow sticky trap. We use these green cages. It helps to reduce the amount of vertebrate bycatch, be that small birds, because these yellow sticky traps are very, very sticky. It could be lizards, geckos, the occasional small pet or even small child attached to your sticky trap. Then after a week, we wouldn't leave it out any further, any more than a week, because the insects begin to degrade. If you have a large outbreak of TPP, the traps will be fairly covered in them, like this one on the right. This one on the right was actually came from a property in Perth, which was a very small planter box, but it had one of the highest loads of TPP that we've seen here. There were over 2,000 TPP on that particular sticky trap. So what are we doing to look for TPP in Australia? Well, since 2019, we had a Hort Innovation Australia project for national surveillance of TPP. The aims of the project were to look for early detection of TPP in the other states and in regional Western Australia. We also wanted to have further confidence that Australia was free of CLSO. So we were tasked with doing more testing of TPP. And it wasn't supposed to take over from the current surveillance, mainly in regional areas for TPP. But it was meant to be focused on the urban areas of the capital cities of the other states and territories, because as we saw in Perth and Western Australia, TPP turned up and established very quickly here in Perth rather than the regional areas. So Western Australia, Department of Primary Industries and Regional Development are leading the project. We have every state and territory involved and collaborating with us on this besides the ACT. Each state and territory is responsible for recruiting their own adopter trappers, doing their own identifications, testing, and liaising with industry. Of course, Western Australia will offer help for secondary identifications or CLSO testing if it's required. The idea was to look in urban areas and the peri-urban fringes, except in Western Australia, where we're looking at regional centres, and the project was to run for 3 years. So what does that actually mean for Australia? Well, in Western Australia, we selected the regional areas of Kununurra, Carnarvon, Geraldton and Albany to send out traps. We've had 250 traps set out annually. In Eastern Australia, it was about 600 traps annually were set up in the major cities, and in Northern Territory, a few more. Now, this may seem like a lot of traps, but in actual fact, we had to send out more traps than this because the objective of the project was to get these traps back and assess them. When you're employing adopter trappers, you don't always get back the traps that you send out. So in most cases, the different jurisdictions had to send out a lot more traps than, say, 600 in Brisbane or Tasmania. This is an example of a call out for some adopter trappers, one from the Northern Territory on the left and from Tasmania on the right, put up on Facebook page. Northern Territory has been extremely successful. They had to close each round because they had more trappers than they needed. So they only needed, 120 trappers to do 4 to 6 weeks of trapping. Once we got our adopter trappers, the idea was to standardise our surveillance across the country. So we all set it up in a very similar way. Each adopter trapper was given a sentinel plant. In most cases, this was a tomato because, as we saw in Western Australia, TPP really, really liked the tomatoes and seemed to be attracted to them over a lot of other different types of plants. We also gave our trappers a series of yellow sticky traps because we needed them to trap for generally 4 weeks. So each week would have a different trap. They got a protector cage and a few other things such as registration stickers so that we could tell the different trappers apart. In some areas, we gave out prepaid return envelopes to help the trappers return their sticky traps to us and help promote that. Each adopter trapper was asked to put in a My Pest Guide report, which is an app that you can download onto your phone. It's very, very easy to use. And this way we could tell whether or not, for instance, whether they'd set up the trap correctly next to their sentinel plant, where they actually were located, because some people took a trap saying that they were in one suburb, but yet they were perhaps setting it up at their parents' place. These photos are examples of their people setting up and using My Pest Guide reporter to report their setup. When a person made a report, they stated which state they were in, and this automatically then went into a folder where nobody else from other states could see that report. So there were, because of obviously there's privacy concerns. This is just a image of different traps set up from around the country, from the very wet, soggy looking trap down in Tasmania up to the tropical gardens of Darwin and Kununurra. So a whole different variety of garden situations. And it's incredibly surprising that we found in Perth that those sorts of planter boxes that you can see on the far right can hold so many TPP, even though they're such a small area. Now, not only is it important that adopter trappers set up properly, but that we had a good spread of adopter trappers across these regions that we're trying to trap in. So, for example, this is a map of Kununurra showing the Ord River running down the middle and the different growing regions on either side. We had a good spread. This is just one trapping season. We had a good spread throughout the growing region, but in the inset, we also had quite a good spread within Kununurra itself. This is one season of trapping in Sydney. You see most of the traps are clustered within the Sydney basin. We've got the odd trap outside of Sydney, but the majority are within that Sydney basin. So what did we actually find? Well, our first trapping was in spring 2019. We had an initial workshop to get set up and going in August of 2019 with all the different states and territories. And then we sprang into action as fast as we could. We trapped in each of our regional centres in Western Australia. We had 100 traps per regional area. So that meant we needed 25 adopter trappers who were going to trap for over 4 weeks. In Kununurra, we found no TPP for this first season. In Carnarvon, we found one male, unfortunately. We found many TPP at Geraldton, and we found 21 down in Albany, so a moderate number. So this indicated to us that TPP had made it to those regional centres already. And if you'll remember, TPP came into the state or was first detected in February 2017. So it seemed like quite a short period of time that it had been able to move. We think by movement of plant material across the southwest of the state. For the rest of Australia, we've found over the last 3 years that COVID and lockdowns have made it really difficult often to get traps out, to get traps back to during our sampling seasons. So we've actually extended the project until the end of this year, but most states have actually finished trapping this autumn, all except Northern Territory. They are still trapping through their growing season, which is currently occurring. most states and territories that meant had over 1,800 traps that were sent out and sent back to the labs and assessed for TPP. And in amongst all of those traps, we haven't found a single TPP except those regional centres in Western Australia, which I outlined. So we can relatively confidently say that TPP has been restricted down to the southwest of Western Australia. It doesn't occur in the Kimberley in the north of Western Australia, which means that we've got a quarantine area where we can't move host material without special permits and treatment up into the Kimberley region of Western Australia. We've since found that it is in Esperance as well. So it's really along that strip in the wheat belt and out to the coastal areas of Western Australia. I thought I'd give you a quick rundown of what we actually do in the labs, concentrating on the CLSO testing. So once we have a trap and it's been left out for a week, this is actually the garden. This image on the left is the garden with the highest load of TPP that we've ever had, over 2000 TPP on that one trap. That gets sent into our labs with the appropriate paperwork. Under a microscope, we identify and count every TPP. We circle these as long as when there were 2000, we couldn't circle them, but we, if we've got fewer, we try and circle them to count them. We then cut out a certain number for CLSO testing. We take them off the sticky trap. That's anywhere between 10 and 20 TPP per trap, depending on the area that we're taking it from. These are then extracted off the sticky trap, off the glue and out of the plastic. We put them into extraction machines so that we can extract the juices out of the TPP. Then they go into PCR machines to look for the molecular markers for CLSO. So as I mentioned before, we have an annual target of 1,690 TPP to collect from the Perth region for testing for CLSO annually. And not only that, but we're trying to spread that across the whole of Perth, and we want 130 TPP at least per local government area. This is a rather fuzzy map of Perth on the right. But it's the important thing is to note is that it's split up into those areas that we're trying to take the 130 TPP from. So far, despite trapping every spring and autumn, we have not detected CLSO. So that's a pretty high level of confidence that we have that we in on mainland Australia, we don't have CLSO yet. So if you wanted to trap for TPP in your crops, how would you go about it? Well, if you were a bit worried that you had TPP and or CLSO, the easiest way is to set up a yellow sticky trap. You can get these yellow sticky traps from hardware stores. We strongly recommend that you get these protector cages to reduce that vertebrate bycatch, but also to make handling a lot easier. It's very hard to deal with a yellow sticky trap by itself, whereas these cages, you can mount them on a stake or you can bulldog clip them to things. And then when you take them off, you can they're fairly easy to deal with. You set the sticky trap up just at the tops of the plants, as you can see in this photo. Leave it out for a week, and it depends on where you are as to when you should actually set these up, but we want it done in the growing seasons and when TPP are most likely to be around. Now, TPP don't like very hot weather, and they go off and overwinter in cold weather. So their optimal range is around 26 degrees Celsius. So in Tasmania, that means trapping should be done over the summer, preferably between November and February. In the northern areas of Australia, like in the Northern Territory or Northern WA or Northern Queensland, between May and August. And in most other areas, TPP would be around in autumn or spring. The The crops that TPP likes to feed on are sweet potato, capsicum, tomato, chili, eggplant, potato, basically any solanaceous crop they will go on. They also feed on weeds. However, we've found that really tomato, they really like tomato. So if you're trapping in a crop of potato, no problem. But if you're going to try and look in your own backyard, then it's probably good to put your yellow sticky trap near a tomato plant. After your trap has been out for a week and looks like this, hopefully not as bad as this, covered in TPP, and you opened up your cage to take the sticky trap out, we prefer that you didn't submit any sticky traps just as is, because they're awfully sticky and they'll attach to anything, and it makes it very hard to look under the microscope at them. What we do with our adopter trappers is we give everyone these clear plastic sheets, which are basically sleeves that you put in files, except we've cut the sides so that they can be opened up like a book, with that white spine remaining connected. Then we just place the yellow sticky trap in that plastic sleeve, close the sleeve up, and it protects the yellow sticky trap and all the insects on it without damaging them, but it still allows us to look under the microscope for those TPP. We need information on where, when, who, what crop, and why you want us to look at this sticky trap. So for each state and territory, we have standard forms for insect samples. I think at the end of this, Brian or Steph will be sharing these resources for each state and territory with you. You can download the appropriate form for your particular state or territory. In Queensland, they do things slightly differently, and they'd like biosecurity samples to go through their online customer service pages or portals. We will make that information available to you as well. We, through this surveillance project, this three-year national surveillance project, we set up a network of Psyllid experts around the country. We have one or more per state or territory. So if you do actually have what you think is a potential TPP, these are the people and the places which to contact. The information on where to send your traps will be on those forms, but this particular slide will also be made available to you at the end of this seminar. So thank you. Is there any questions for me?
There was one question in the Q&A function, but I think you may have covered it. The question was, have you discovered any new incursions of TPP in WA, i.e. airport captures, other than the initial incursion? So I think this one has been answered, but I'm not sure if you'd like to add
any. It kind of has. We discovered through this project TPP in Geraldton, Albany and Carnarvon. But we found that with the adopter trappers, that it was actually pretty useless setting up traps just on the side of the road next to no sentinel plants, or even near like deadly nightshade, other solanaceous plants. We didn't tend to capture many TPP, or if any. So it was more beneficial to trap in people's backyards where they may not be spraying much, and TPP really then start to build up a fairly big population in people's backyards.
Thanks, Melinda. There have been no other, there's one more that's popped up actually. Kate's jumped in the chat. Do you know which country the WA TPP incursion came from?
I would say no, because the New Zealand one came from North America, I believe. I think the genetics shows that the TPP here in Perth very similar to North America and to New Zealand. So I think there are different varieties, different molecular morphs, variations in North America, but I believe New Zealand only has the one. So we can't tell exactly where it's come from.
Great. Thank you, Melinda. There might be some more questions that pop through in the Q&A in the chat. I might hand over to John, if that's okay. We'll see if John can share his screen. Thank you very much, Melinda. That was a great presentation.
Can you start my video, please?
Yep, I've got my tech over here helping. Yep, very good. Got you there.
Okay, I think it may be better if you just launch that presentation, I think, and save a bit of time.
Yeah, sure.
Trying me to bring it up. It'll also be quicker to go through.
All right. I'll just check that you can see the presentation there.
Yes, I can. Yep.
Okay.
Perfect. Okay, so thank you for the opportunity to talk to everyone. I'll just start off and so obviously this is covering the Canterbury Potato Liberibacter initiative that was launched in Canterbury. So first of all, the next slide, we'll just talk about the background of the TPP in New Zealand. So next. So yeah, so the background to tomato potato psyllid incursion into NZ. So it first arrived in Auckland, it was in around 2006, and it spread quickly throughout the North Island. And it then continued on its journey within 5 or 6 years, it continued on to Invercargill, and Invercargill being the bottom of the South Island. So it spread very quickly New Zealand wide. Wasn't expected to, didn't expect it to be spread as quickly as it did. And at the time actually considered it was probably more of a North Island problem than the South Island problem, but it didn't seem to worry the psyllid. It spread New Zealand wide. Although the Liberibacter bacteria is not carried by all TPP psyllid populations, only a percentage of psyllids will carry the bacteria, and these psyllids are classed as hot psyllids, which cause zebra chip in crisps and fries. The zebra chip issue only initially was caused mainly an issue in the North Island, in processing plants until 2015. And from 2015, hot psyllids carried LSO basically started to be detected in Canterbury. So the bacteria, again, it followed on behind and took some time before it arrived in Canterbury. But since then, the populations of psyllids and the LSO up until this season, just gone by, in 2021-2022 season, the numbers are just populations continue to increase, and the presence of LSO had continued to increase. From 2015, insecticide programs have improved for sure and reduced psyllid populations. There have also been other initiatives tried with varying levels of success over the years with TPP populations. It's important to know that zebra chip observed in infected tubers affects each potato cultivar differently, with varying levels of zebra chip which can be seen in the raw state. So it's not always the same in every potato variety. In the processing line, especially when they've been peeled, you can see that some varieties are affected different than others. But also to point out that actually when it's a problem and when it's very severe, it's also a problem in fresh potatoes as well, because it will be slightly glassy. They'll be glassy and they detract from the appearance of potatoes, especially once you peel them. So it's not altogether a processing issue. Next. So in Canterbury, one thing we found was that there's along the coast, on the north side of the, on the top side of the Rakaia, we've got a big stand of African boxthorn. And it's about 400 meters long. You can see how tall it is. So it's quite tall. It's a huge block of African boxthorn. And psyllid, it's just the ideal habitat. They just love the thing. When we first realized the problem, and so this is where the populations was really building up and it was starting from. And in boxthorn, they are there by their trillions. They are absolutely masses of them. And there's huge numbers on every leaf. And you can imagine how many leaves there are. In a big stand like this, that's 400 meters long, and there are other stands like this in south of the Rakaia. But this is one of the big problems that we've got with it. We did have ideas of actually going to bulldoze the whole lot and burn it, but in the end, we were advised against it because the fact that it is actually a lure, and so it's something that we can actually try and to deal with them rather than actually try and destroy a big host area and then have the psyllids actually spread all over the place. But anyway, so next slide. And before we formed CPI, so what actually flagged our the problem we could see in Canterbury was, and this slide here shows the average number. So the average number of psyllids. So once you get one psyllid on a trap in that season, then we then class that as psyllid has been detected. So this is in the time during the season. And the heat units and when psyllids actually arrived in the crop. So if you look down to the bottom right in 2019, 2020 season, it actually really didn't turn up. Psyllid didn't turn up to the 5th of December. And so if you had seed growers, fresh market growers, process growers, all got different ideas, all using different insecticide programs, all got away different ways of attack. So some of them would be saying, well, we're not actually spraying. We don't actually start spraying to the 5th of December. So that's fine. But then if you look at the other end in 2021, in the 2020-2021 season, when LSO, zebra chip and the psyllids was a major, major problem that year. It's really showing there that they actually started, those guys that are starting to spray, and whether it's late November or it's early December, they're starting almost 3 weeks too late. So they haven't allowed for the different accumulation of heat units in that season that when psyllids have arrived earlier, but they've been basically on a calendar spray program. And so what we were saying is, well, they're starting far, far too late. We need to get everybody on the same page, and how are we going to do that? And that was one of the reasons why we actually formed the Canterbury Potato Liberibacter Initiative, to try and get all farmers, agronomists, everyone on the same page on how to deal with this thing. Because up until 2020-2021, it's been basically a bit of a failure about trying to deal with it. So next slide. So we formed a committee, and probably in my 40 years in potatoes in the processing sector, what's pretty neat about this committee, and the reason I put it up there, is we've got every processing company on it. It's the first time that I would have been on something where we've had every processing company involved with trying to deal with this issue. Where you've got McCain, you've got Tellies, you've got Heinz, you've got Mr. Chips, we've got process growers, seed growers, Potatoes NZ, and we've got a representation from Canterbury University and Plant and Food Research, and so really a lot of like-minded people trying to find a solution to deal with it. And this, just as a photo, one of the farmers had developed was that for early in the season to do spray program for trying to get the bottom leaves of the plant, where he's made actually a spray boom, which actually has bottom spray nozzles as well as top spray nozzles, so he can actually get coverage right down through the plant to control it. So next slide. So obviously with TPP, that we were, for a start, we're looking at cultural practices. So what's everybody doing? Trying to get everyone to do the same thing at the same time as the year, so we can actually get on top of the population. So it actually is not getting out of control. So if one farmer is doing one thing, that the next farmer over the fence isn't doing something totally different, so that we can actually try and control this population. So next slide. So the early observations were that if you look at, there was the key to the knowledge is what's happening in your paddock and the environment around it. So obviously it was getting out with sticky traps. So a lot of different people were using sticky traps, but not sharing the data. So we got people out there, to get out there scouting to what are the life stages of the psyllid in your crop with the nymphs in stage 1 to 3, and then 4 and 5 nymphs and adults. What stage is in your crop? What is the growing degree accumulation in your area? And it's actually sharing the trapping data and sharing the control programs. So the plan then was to start insecticide programs early in relation to growing degree day accumulation, spray diaries, analysis, and to suggest a good strategy, appears to be that when the crop has emerged and psyllids appear on the first sticky trap to start your spray program. So next slide. So we also shared a lot of information. So we basically, if it doesn't go to the mobile phone for a farmer, it's just not going to see it. So a lot of the stuff was going to their mobile phone. So we were sharing where McCain might have had a lot of information and other processes might have been doing other things, was actually everyone was sharing it. So we're actually looking then at different temperature stations. This one's actually in Chertsey. And so the lines, the black lines across here are the different generations. So you can see there throughout the season, there was a total of four generations. So it's then looking at the different heat unit accumulation between the different seasons. So then you can, we can try and track to see whether we are behind or ahead of that. And so they're giving the farmers information so they know whether they're ahead or behind, so they can actually make sure that their spray program is either on the case or they've got a bit of room to move. So next slide. We also shared then, because we were sharing all the trapping data, we then also shared the Canterbury region, and we also put all the information onto a map, and then we share that map with everyone. And the numbers in red, when it comes up red, it means that the last time it was trapped, there were psyllids present. When it's amber, or the orangey colour, I should say, it's that colour if there were no psyllids detected the previous time. And then it also counts across the numbers. It will be pretty hard to read there, but it tells you that in each week, that they are trapping data of the number of psyllids that were detected on those traps. So therefore, that you've got all the information, you can see what's going on, you can see what's going on in your area and north and south and with your neighbours. So next slide. We also shared all this trapping data on a slide. Now the top one here, and you'll see the green line across the bottom, and I can't put my pointer on this, but this was 2021-2022 season, so it was a lot lower. But then if you look at the 2020-21 season, which is in the purple, there were some real high peaks, and that's when it really got out of control in 2020-21, and we had a major problem. And it was simply because I think we look back, everyone was doing something different than the neighbor. And instead of all using a particular insecticide at a particular time, and a critical one was at the start of the season that when farmers, it's important to be using soft chemistry that isn't killing the beneficial insects. So if you're killing the beneficial insects, bingo, you nuke the whole field, you kill everything. The first thing that arrives back after the spray will be the psyllids, and they'll arrive back with a vengeance and the biggest numbers. So we had to get everyone for a start to using soft chemistry and making sure that they protected the beneficial insects and didn't kill their beneficials. And you can see in the 2021-22 season in the green that we really had a lot lower results. So that was pleasing, but whether that was also caused by the fact that it was a cooler, wetter season, we don't know. But we'll know more this year, but we think it must have had a benefit simply by everyone doing a similar thing at a similar time. So next slide. So a whole toolbox approach to Liberibacter was, understanding the natural enemies, the timing of monitoring, the insecticides, non-insecticide control, spray off dates. And that's a critical one too, is actually looking at when we spray the crops off. So they're not sitting there at the end of the season, sort of growing on, losing color. As soon as they start to lose a bit of color, then the psyllids will come in with, you get more psyllids flying in. And it's looking at sort of, forecasting when we should actually spray crops off and have sort of almost a mandatory kill date. And then TPP host plants. So next slide. So just quickly, and I won't go through all this, but we put together key initiatives for CPLI was in the short term. And the first thing that we did was really to test the efficacy of the seven contact insecticides. So we could make sure they didn't have any resistance, because there was a thought that fairly amongst growers that where there was resistance to their some of these chemicals. And then we also tested the systemic insecticide products, which is a lot more involved and took longer to do, but it's only just been completed. And we also found there no resistance in those products anyway. So what that was really saying that, okay, there isn't any problem with resistance to insecticides, but it's really probably saying that there's probably some work that needs to be done with the way crops have been sprayed in spray programs. We're also looking to send out a fact sheet early in the season so that everyone's trying to get everybody on the same page of how they were doing it. We're doing nature strips for beneficial predatory insects on headlands and outside of fields. looked at the analysing the spray diaries from all the growers. You know, we took the, what were the 10 best crops? What happened in there? What were the 10 worst ones? What did they do? You know, looking at like some fish fertiliser products. I guess one of the big things that we found is that there was a real gap. There was a real gap in the knowledge of in TPP and LSO. So we had a real gap in knowledge, and I guess some of that knowledge was might have been, if there was knowledge there, it was probably held by too few people. So one of the things is to build our knowledge and learn more about it, get it out down there to the farmers so everyone knows how to deal with this thing, and so that so not dumb it down, but to get it to the level so everyone understands what we should be doing, what's the best management practices of how to go about this. So next slide. So that's really what we were doing. We also went out with funding. So we put out a levy of $1.50 a tonne from the growers and the processors, seed industry, anyone that would was interested in donating. And, you know, we were at a target of getting $650K. So we only, target was to go to the trough once, not to be actually having to go back for more and more money, just we want money straight up and down and go and spend it on dealing to this project, but not have to come back again and hopefully solve it. And by getting industry funding and grower funding, it also allows us to get access to government funding. Next slide. So probably one of the things with nature strips, so we planted nature strips around on some of the potato fields to see what would happen if we can actually build up our predatory insects, being lace wings and hoverflies, and as well, you know, with phacelia, buckwheat, clovers, any, we had to be just careful that we weren't, because Canterbury also does a lot of brassica seed production and vegetable seed production. We also didn't want to be actually causing problem with pollination of those crops. So we had to be in contact with those industries to make sure that we were planting what we call perhaps weed, you know, nature strips that weren't going to affect other seed crops as well. And we did a big release of tamarixia. So you can see there on those slides that we've got the nature strips around the field. So next slide. Host plants. So what we found is there's an awful lot of host plants, and that's just some of them that that can live on. So it's not just boxthorn, although it obviously absolutely loves boxthorn, but it's out there, and it's also in a lot of New Zealand natives. So to say that you're going to eradicate all the host plants isn't going to happen. And because there's a lot of natives that are also host plants, it's not, you know, obviously not eradicate those either. So you know, it's out there in Canterbury on a lot of other plants other than potatoes. So next slide. So MPI biological control. So what we were looking at was predatory insects, so the damsel bugs, miniature pirate bugs, then the larger pirate bug, brown lacewings, hoverfly larvae, ladybird, and parasitic what tamarixia. So what we actually found with some of the, and this is the pirate bugs, is that, and you can see where they've been feeding between the red and the yellow on that little slide down there. But what I actually found was that they've actually found that they don't necessarily, they probe, but they don't actually necessarily feed on that on that nymph. So they might probe it and just kill it and then move on to the next one. Now why that is we don't know, but they actually don't feed on every one. They probe it, good job, because it kills the thing, but it's probably to try and understand why that is, whether they just don't like the taste of that one, or whether that was might have been a hot psyllid or something. We don't know, but they don't feed off every nymph. Also interesting that you know, the tamarixia hasn't had a great deal of effect up until now on killing psyllids. It seems to be getting wiped out, but I'll talk about this later on. So we'll just move on to the next slide. So what we found, because although we had visions of bulldozing all this boxthorn out, we're advised from Clive Kaiser, who's the associate professor at Lincoln University, not to, because it was a he said to us, you've got a great lure there, it lures them in, so why are they there, why are they leaving, and it gave a good opportunity. So what we did with these was about five different beneficial insects. We released the whole lot, and we went down there and they released the whole lot on this boxthorn, and just to see what would happen. And they tell me later that it doesn't really get done like that overseas. They would tend to release one insect at a time and try and monitor it and see what it does. But we released we released the five of them. But and then they actually came back some weeks later, and to their surprise, they'd actually made a pretty big impact, which was like a bit of a shock. So they then decided that we'd put up these four traps on a pole, put up there at different heights to see what was happening and see how they're moving around. And so we've actually then gone back time and time again, and they have the different beneficial insects. They all travel different distances down the hedge. And so these traps are spaced at sort of 50 meter intervals down this hedge. And they have traveled different distances, but they somehow have supported each other. So where tamarixia doesn't have much effect, in this case, now that we've got other predatory insects here, tamarixia numbers have built up and have a much greater impact. So there's obviously was something that was cleaning out the tamarixia, which isn't cleaning that bug out now because of these other beneficial insects. And so we don't know what that is, but it certainly has been a huge surprise. And interesting, in middle of winter, in July, now we did get a lot of rain in July, but we can't find any psyllids. So whether the beneficials have cleaned them out or whether it's the wet winter that's cleaned them out, we don't know where the psyllid's gone. And so there's going to be a lot of time spent down there trying to find out when they arrive and then how quickly the numbers build up. So it's been a huge learning experience. So next slide. So going forward, so the plans for this next season, so is TPP management of potato crops. We're looking at developing an effective attractant to kill and lure the potato psyllid. We're looking at actually also a calcium proportionate to prevent the spread has actually been used in citrus to some benefit. So we're looking at doing some work on that. We're going to buy an SA proposal, identify an LSO infield quick test in plants. And we've actually got a test that looks like we can actually identify LSO in the field in about it's about a 30-second test, and it's very quick and it's very cheap. So that's a real plus. So we're now doing the scientific work behind it to make sure that it works. We're looking at nature strips and beneficial insects and biological control agents. We're also looking at endotypes, grass teas, and we've got formed a partnership with Potatoes NZ, Lincoln Uni as a support partnership. Next slide. We're also looking at, IPM control, we're looking at also oversides to use earlier in the season. So actually trying to take the nymphs out right at the beginning, because we think there's probably a gap here because a lot of farmers are going out and spraying and targeting the adults, where maybe better be targeting in the nymphs and try to take that early population out, because the adults will be coming in anyway. And if early on, if we can take out the nymphs, we actually may have an effect on the population. So there's going to be a lot of work done going forward on obviously looking at oversides, tropical sides and nymphosides and early in the season to see if we can have an effect, because we can knock the numbers out early. It may have a huge impact later in the season with less reliance on insecticides as well. Next slide. And just on the timing about that, around planting, about crop monitoring, using oversides and then nymphs and then biological control agents at the different timing through the year as well. So next slide. Also looking at traps. So we've come up, it's been used in the US where they've come up with a trap, it's 3D printed for trapping psyllids. And it particularly in this case, it only traps psyllids. I'm assuming there will be some other insects getting there, but it actually, one of the problems is when you've got a huge number of insects on a trap is trying to identify the psyllids and the time it takes. So this is actually a purpose-built psyllid trap. So next slide. And so we've done a modification here in New Zealand. Now forget the color, this is just a prototype, so it will be yellow. And so we've come up with, we've done some work on this and versus the US model, and we have to thank the Americans for this, but we're looking, there's a little cap there you can see on the slide across a little tube that screws onto that trap, and that's where the psyllids will collect. So the psyllids will come through the hole, go down the trap, into the tube, into that little tube, and we will have in there a antifreeze, and we will antifreeze, and then they can just farmer or whoever's collecting it can just actually unscrew it, screw another one on, put a cap on it, and send it away. The plan is to then send these to the US, and there's a scientist or a researcher over there that's identified 250 plants in testing the what's in the psyllid's stomach to see what the psyllid's been feeding on. And we're going to be sending these to the US so we can actually find out what plants, where do psyllids go in the wintertime, what are they eating, what are they feeding on, so we can actually find all the starter out and then hopefully target them. They're also looking at the factors. So in the bowl, in the bottom of that bowl, we can also put a lure in there. So the fact that you can't see it here because it's black, but there's other little holes around there. And so we could actually put a lure, if we can come up with a lure, we'll put a lure in there that will actually, other than the color, we'd also have the lure to attract the psyllids and trap them. So that's going to be very exciting. So no doubt, Melinda, that you'd be probably keen to get hold of a couple of these to try them anyway. But then once we have this prototype perfected, we'll then, and it's probably been done about now, has been injection molded. Cost-wise, we expect they'll be under $5 each. So that's the plan. Next slide. What does success look like? So sorry I had to rush through this, but there's a lot of slides to get through. But what does success look like beyond 2022? Increased profitability and parable yield, no reject crops for on potatoes. Zebra chip under 0.2%, under 0.2% defect level at the factories. Improved seed quality, improved forecasting management tools to TPP and LSO, a clear vision of a pathway forward to reduce reliance on insecticides, better understanding of nature strips, how to use them, beneficial and predatory insects and biological alternatives. So next slide. Just acknowledgements. So we've got to acknowledge Canterbury University, Clive Kaiser, Hamish Gow, and we've got some young students. I mean, we've sort of formed a bit of a partnership. We've got some master's students and PhDs at the university doing projects on this for us as well. So there's been a great collaboration with the university, and really looking at an extension model with Lincoln University in the potatoes and especially on TPP going forward. So that's been brilliant. Great support from Potatoes NZ. Great support from Plant and Food Research, and they've been doing some of these testing the insecticides. And I didn't cover that off, but also we've been testing systemically applied resistance products as well. And so we've been testing those plant food. Also Bioforce, thanks to Bioforce for supplying biological agents to be tested in these studies. So I've covered a fair bit of ground there, but it's been pretty fascinating. I guess in my 40 years, I didn't think I'd be so fascinated with insects, but we can see with some of these, especially with biological control that and with trapping and the way we've perhaps been trapping psyllids, that we can start to make a big impact on this population. So any questions?
Thank you for that, John. That was a really great presentation. It just showed how collaborating with other industry partners can really push the outcome in the right direction. So I think you achieved some great things with some lots of challenges by the sounds of things. So you've done very well as an industry to get to that point.
I'll just quote, Potatoes NZ did say to us that when we got this going, they said, you guys have done more in 7 months than the industry has achieved in 7 years. We have covered a lot of ground in a hurry, but the pressure's on. So we want results.
Definitely. There was a comment in the chat here. Frank Mulcahy has said, two fantastic presentations, all the best going forward, John. It's been a huge challenge for your industry. So hats off to you. Were there any questions for the speakers? Had one actually for Melinda. I'm curious, what happens if we do actually identify CLSO or Liberibacter in Australia through your surveillance program?
Well, then I gather that another incident will be called and we'll try and eradicate the population of TPP that have those. So it's reassuring to hear from John that not every population had the CLSO.
Thank you. We've got someone that's popped their hand up as well. We'll just see if we can bring them off mute. Danielle, you should be able to come off mute now if you'd like to.
Thank you. So I'm Danielle, I'm from the Stardy Molecular Diagnostic in Adelaide. I just wanted, at least I think it's a good follow up on your question because just wanted to put it out there that Stardy was funded back in 2018-2020 by Hort Innovation to develop a high throughput diagnostic system for CLSO from potato tubers. So if it was ever to come to that, there is a system that is existing in Australia for high throughput diagnostic directly from tubers, potato tubers. So it was just more like a comment rather than a question, but yeah.
Thank you, Danielle. Your sound did drop out for a little bit there. So yeah, I think we caught what you said. Were there any other questions for our speakers today? Okay. I just wanted to share very briefly just some resources on where you can go to find more information. So these will be linked on the website along with the forms that you can fill out for each of the states and your key contact regional representative across the country. So DPIRD have a great page on their website on Liberibacter. AusVeg and Plant Health Australia have also produced an information sheet. Plant Health Australia have produced one as well. It's a fact sheet, and the PERSA group have produced a page. So we'll definitely link those on the website so you can access them. And also just wanted to highlight as well that we do have a couple of events coming up in the upcoming weeks. This one in Manjimup is next week. We also have another one in collaboration with the AusPicker Conference. So the AusPicker Conference will be held in Ballarat this year on the 6th of October, and it will run from 10 a.m. till about 5 p.m. They have a charity dinner afterwards. In collaboration with that, the PotatoLink team will have an R&D forum where we'll have speakers much like Melinda, so someone from her project will represent the Victorian group there, which would be great. Kate is on the line at the moment, so it's a good opportunity to come along and hear the latest of projects that are occurring in the potato industry. And there's also, in collaboration with the conference, but on the following day, there's a Fresh and Processing Potatoes Pest and Disease Technical Forum. So this is a forum where we can hear your ideas, some challenges, and brainstorm ideas for future research opportunities, particularly around pest and disease. And any feedback that's received during that event will be taken to Hort Innovation for consideration for future research. So it's a good opportunity for people to come along. So with that, unless there are further questions, I'd just like to say a huge thank you to both Melinda and John for coming on the webinar today. It produced a really great overview of the situation in Australia, but then also some really important learnings that we could take should the situation change in Australia that we can learn from the New Zealand potato industry. So I'd like to thank you very much for your time in preparation for the event, but also for being here today. And before people log off, just there's a survey that will pop up after the webinar requesting if you rate it, how you rate the webinar, but also if you have any suggestions or topics for future events. I'll pause there. Getting lots of thank yous coming in the chat. So thank you to Melinda and John, appreciate it. All right, we'll wrap it up there. Thank you for joining everybody, and hope you have a good day.
Thanks, see ya.